Vedanta Research Center. It's my great honor and privilege to welcome all the esteemed guests and dignitaries on the book launch of Narrative Analysis of Bhagavad Puran, authored by Dr. Shakuntala Gowreji. The book will be inaugurated at the hands of Keith D'Souza, Father Keith D'Souza, Rector, St. Xavier's College, Father Dr. Arun D'Souza, Director, Heras Institute of Indian Culture and St. Xavier's College, Professor Rajendra Shinde, Principal, St. Xavier's College, Baldev Dasji, and Jessica Merritt from Indiana University, Bloomington. The Bhaktivedanta Research Center Trust is an ISO 9001 certified not-for-profit center and academic institute affiliated to the University of Mumbai for master's and PhD degree program at the Savitri Bai Phule Pune University for research. Bhaktivedanta Research Center is dedicated to preserve, research, and disseminate the rich history, philosophy, and cultural heritage of India, as well as to create awareness and foster cooperation on these studies internationally. It is headquartered in Kolkata and has branches in Mumbai, Pune, and Puri, and is partnering with several academic institutions in India and across the globe, such as Oxford Center for Hindu Studies, National Philosophical Counseling Association, USA, Stockholm University, Jadavpur University, and the St. Xavier's College, Kolkata. BRC has been collecting, preserving, and digitizing thousands of manuscripts and rare books from remote villages, temples, and libraries across the Indian subcontinent over the last dozen years. BRC holds carefully and selected collection of about 50,000 ancient books, journals, and newspapers, including many from the colonial period. The collection comprises of updated reference books, bibliographies, conference proceedings, translations, manuscripts, biographies and autobiographies, among other reference material of Indic and Asian origin. We are also creating state-of-art digital libraries of this ancient wisdom in collaboration with renowned academic institutions such as Stockholm University, Jadavpur University, and West University of Timisoara, Romania. Our mission is thus to unearth this knowledge and make it readily available to the society at large. BRC is registered under the Raja Ram Mohan Roy Library Foundation, established by the Ministry of Culture. BRC is developing comprehensive digital collection with state-of-art digital libraries, providing access to read, search, and download the wealth of ancient wisdom. The state-of-art digital library projects for this year include the Indian Philosophical Journals of Colonial Bengal in collaboration with Jadavpur University, and Darshan Manisha Digital Library Collection, consisting of works of 15th and 16th century Sanskrit and Bengali philosophical scholars pertaining to the Navya Nyaya system of logic. We are also discussing with St. Xavier's College, Kolkata, to establish a center for inter-religious study. Along with Stockholm University, the center wants to organize lectures, series, conferences, and a yearly summer school for PhD and postdoctoral students, where figures, topics, and critical issues relating to the history and theologies of major religion could be tackled, starting from the analysis of primary sources. Scholars of Hinduism, Jewish, Christian, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, tribal religion, Islamic history, theologians, and culture and art historian belonging to both the center and international institution will take part in the summer school as guest lectures. Center will collect and publish the results of his scientific activities in book series. The outcome of the center.
Namo Namaha. All respected dignitaries sitting on the dais, Baldev Prabhuji, Dr. Rajendra Shinde, Dr. Father Arun D'Souza, Jessica Merritt, and Dr. Sumanta Rudra. Scholars, friends, students, well-wishers, and my family members. My humble pranams to all. I stand before you today with a heart filled with gratitude and excitement as we gather to celebrate the book launch of A Narrative Analysis of Bhagavad Puran. It is an immense pleasure to share my thoughts and insights on this journey that has led us to this moment. I was teaching Bhagavad Purana to my master's students. It captivated my mind, heart, and intellect. The Bhagavad Purana, also known as Srimad Bhagavatam, holds a unique position among the sacred texts of ancient Indian literature. It is not just a religious scripture, but a treasure trove of philosophy, spirituality, morality, folk tales, and legends. As a narrative of love, devotion, and enlightenment, it captivates the hearts and minds of countless readers across cultures and ages. It is said about Bhagavata Purana that it is the fruit of Vedic desire. It was rightly described by Baldev Prabhuji. So it is said that Nigama Kalpa Taroho Galitam Phalam Shuka Mukhat Amruta Drava Sanyutam Pibata Bhagavatam Rasamalayam Muhuhu Aho Rasikaha Bhuvi Bhavikaha. It is a fruit of Vedic desire containing ambrosial juice and has issued from the mouth of Shukadev. So it is said that, O Rasikas, O devotees, drink again and again the reservoir of rasa, the Bhagavata. Bhagavata Mahatmya says that Bhagavata is the essence of Vedas and Upanishads. Bhagavata is considered as the fruit of Vedic tree. Now there is rasa, that is essence, in each and every part of the tree. But it can be tasted only through the fruit. So Bhagavata is that fruit. So the rasa of the Vedas, Upanishads can be tasted through Bhagavata alone. Taittiriya Upanishad says, raso vai saha. Here rasa is nothing but the ultimate reality, that is Brahman. Lord Krishna is not just avatar in Bhagavata Purana, but he is observed as Purana Brahma, absolute Brahman in Bhagavata. Bhagavata Purana is a rich treasure house of narratives. There are series of connected narrations with different occasions, different narrators, as well as audiences. The chain of narrators is employed to link different narrations in the same thread. Bhagavata can be called as a grand narrative. It has very complex narrative structure. Vyasa is considered as a traditional author of all the Puranas. Sutta is addressing seers of Naimisharanya. At each narrative level, there is change in narrator as well as the audience. Thus, there are several signs of oral narratives in the text. This factor has retained certain folk elements in Bhagavata Purana in the midst of philosophy. As a significant feature of oral narrative, there are ample techniques used to arouse the interest of the listener, that is Shrotru, to teach philosophy and morals. So we can see that in the philosophical text, we see the Siddhantas, that is theories. But in Bhagavata, all these philosophical theories comes through various stories, miraculous stories. So Bhagavata, like all the Puranas, has unique way of teaching morals and philosophy. The 10th skanda of the Bhagavata can be considered the very soul of the Bhagavata Purana. Those stories are very popular. The meaning of some narrative was an enigma. While teaching this to students, I realized that each episode of the 10th skanda has multiple layers of meaning. Bhagavata is multi-layered text. What we can easily get is the superficial meaning. But if we want to understand the real essence of the Bhagavata, we have to read it again and again and understand the deeper meaning of it. So that opportunity came with the World Sanskrit Conference 2015 held in Bangkok, Thailand. I presented a paper on exploring various meanings of Putana episode of Bhagavata Purana. While working on this paper, I was fascinated because I could see Putana from multifarious angle. Because now we just understand Putana as a female demon, that's it. But when we read Bhagavata, Putana is often referred to as Bala Grahi or Bala Ghatin, that is child scissor. So that reference comes again and again. So that is where I realized that this is the narrative code to decode this text, this narrative. Now, while doing the cross-reference work, I realized that there is a section on Balagrahas in Ayurvedic text like Sushruta Samhita, where Putana is also mentioned. It means Putana was a kind of disease which affects the newly born child. I was wondering, what is the etymological meaning of the word Putana? So there is one Sanskrit root, pu, means to purify. But the meaning was not befitting. So there is another meaning, puin, which means putrid, that is bad smell. Now surprisingly, the characteristics of Putana disease are mentioned elaborately in Sushruta Samhita, where it is said that child seized by Putana Graha has a bad smell to that child's body. Now Putana gave her milk by breastfeeding Krishna in order to kill him. Sushruta Samhita mentions one of the reasons for Putana disease can be from breastfed milk. It means Putana may be a kind of disease from which child Krishna survived. It was a victory indeed that child Krishna defeated the terrible disease. This gave an allegorical interpretation of Putana episode. Not only this, I have analyzed Putana's transformation into a mother and devotee because Bhagavatam mentions this narrative as Putana Moksha and not Putana Vadha. It is not that Putana was killed by child Krishna, but it is Bhagavata takes it as the liberation of Putana. Now the question comes that why Putana was liberated? So the meaning must be that she was a devotee, she was the adhikari of the moksha, she was eligible to get liberation. So we have to solve this riddle. So for that, we get the narrative sign or the code in Bhagavata itself. In Bhagavata it is mentioned that there was a fragrance out of her funeral pyre and all were surprised why there is such fragrance. It means that she received the Sadgati. So this is the narrative sign that it suggests that she got liberated. So while doing this, I have used different tools of intertextuality. How the narrative becomes rich? While traveling from Harivamsa, Vishnu Puran, Bhagavata Puran and Brahma Vaivarta Puran. See, Brahma Vaivarta Puran says that Putana is taken to Goloka by gem-studded chariot. Here Putana's salvation is described more elaborately than in the Bhagavata Puran because Brahma Vaivarta Puran comes later than the Bhagavata Puran. So as we progress chronologically, we can see that Puranic text become rich, more elaborate, more vivid. So when there was opportunity to apply for Hera's fellowship, I applied with the project proposal having an idea to interpret the 10th Skanda of Bhagavata Puran. It got shaped in various ways in review meetings conducted by Hera's. I really thank then director Professor June Dias who took initiative in this. The 10th Skanda of Bhagavata Purana is very important as it's the whole Krishna Charitra. These are the popular stories actually known by everyone, known as Krishna Leelas. They were just seen as miraculous stories. What's the deep meaning embedded in these narratives? Bhakti is the thread of the 10th Skanda. But apart from that, historical, sociological, cultural and religious elements are reflected in all those narratives. We know from the title itself, Bhagavata, it is about Bhagavan, that is the Lord. So naturally, bhakti is the essence of the Bhagavata. But apart from that, there are various meanings which are reflected, which we cannot ignore. So I felt while going through the pre-existing research material, because many scholars have worked on Bhagavata, there are ample commentaries available on Bhagavata. So I felt that the toolbox approach would be the right kind of perspective to decode this complex text. Because when I was analyzing Putana episode, I realized that etymological approach is helpful, psychological approach is helpful, similarly scientific approach because it is mentioned in medicinal text also, so that is also important. But when I came across different narrative, different approach was useful. So I decided to use toolbox approach. to decode this complex text, because singular approach, only single approach, may not be sufficient and it will not give justice to the text like Bhagavata. Therefore, it was challenging to explore the meaning of every episode with new set of tools from narratology, etymological, sociological, psychological and philosophical approaches were employed using the framework of narratology while studying selected narratives from Bhagavata Purana's 10th Skanda. This book is the product of research project completed as a part of fellowship conferred by the Heras Institute of Indian Culture, St. Xavier's College and Dorabji Tata Trust. The present book gives an exhaustive introduction dealing with Puranas and the growth of Vaishnavism, which sets a precursor to further analysis. It undertakes hermeneutic interpretation of episodes, that is Lord Krishna's birth story, lifting of Govardhana mountain, Syamantaka jewel, exploits of Putana and other demons, uprooting of Arjuna trees, the expulsion of Kaliya, Gopi Chiraharanam, Rasa Panchadhyayi, story of Kubja, story of Shri Daman and Rukmini Swayamvara. These episodes, these narratives are analyzed in the present book. All these narratives are categorized into three chapters: assimilation and acculturation, this chapter throws light on sociological aspects, exploits of demons. These again, exploits of demons contains multiple different narrative theories and different perspectives, and then bhakti narratives. Krishna stories are popular, but they are just popular as miraculous stories, as I said. And we have heard, like, for example, in Krishna's birth story, flood disappears when child Krishna's feet touches the water. When Yashoda tied child Krishna to the mortar, it was falling short every time. Krishna lifted Govardhana on a finger. Sudaman found his small hut change into royal palace, etc., etc. We have been listening to many such miracles. This connotes more deeper sense. Just like churning of the curd is needed to get the Navaneeta out of it, similarly, textual analysis is essential to derive the meaning from the text. Janet's tool of transtextuality are applied to the text, by which various versions of the Krishna stories are compared and analyzed further. Because Krishna stories are told, retold and understood, described in various manners in different texts prior and later to Bhagavata. Then Rolla Barthes' theory of narrative codes is also applied to narratives to unearth different layers of the human psyche. Because structuralism leads us to understand the structure, the underlying structures. K. Ayyappa Panikkar's model of narratology based on ancient Indian narratives is also taken into consideration to unravel the meaning. Bhagavata is commented upon by different acharyas of different philosophical schools. These commentaries have played significant role in understanding the meaning. Thus, the present book reveals the multiple layers of meaning through the method of narrative analysis. This not only provides a new insight to look at Bhagavata, but opens a new vista of Puranic study as well. It reaffirms the truth that Puranas are meaningful text. Scholars who have already worked on Bhagavata were definitely torchbearers in this whole journey. There is definitely a long way ahead. There is much to explore, more to explore from Bhagavata. Bhagavata is like ocean. I am extremely thankful to the Heras Institute for giving me this opportunity. My heartfelt gratitude to Shilpa Cheda for always being helpful. I am thankful to Dr. Ferdinand Nusardera, Associate Professor of History of Religion, Stockholm University, Sweden, for writing foreword for the book. I express my deepest gratitude to my teacher, Dr. Gauri Mahulikar, Director, Chinmay International Foundation, Kerala, for giving a review of the book and being a constant source of inspiration to me. I thank Dr. Sumanta Rudra for his invaluable support and encouragement to publish this research project in the form of the book. His unwavering belief in me motivated me constantly. I would also like to extend my heartfelt thanks to the Bhaktivedanta Research Center for their sponsorship. Furthermore, my gratitude extends to Dev Publisher and distributors for their collaboration in bringing this work to the public. I'm thankful to my family members, particularly to my dear parents, to whom I have dedicated this book. You have been my pillars of strength from the very beginning. Your endless belief in my abilities, your sacrifices, and your unconditional love have been the foundation upon which I have built my dreams. I take this moment to express my heartfelt thanks to my husband for the significant roles you have played in my life and in the realization of this accomplishment. I am thankful to my in-laws as well, who stood behind me. I am experiencing the immense joy to see all of you here in this book launch. I must express my deepest gratitude to my teachers, mentors, and scholars who guided and supported me on this academic journey. Their insights and encouragement have been invaluable. I'm feeling joyous to see my dearest students who are present here. I'm really happy because they are my strong support system. And really, I get energy from my students to work further, move further. Finally, I wish to express my deepest gratitude to all of you, the readers and the seekers of knowledge who have joined us today. It is my sincere hope that this narrative analysis of Bhagavata Purana will kindle a spark of curiosity within me. I bow down to Lord Krishna, who gave me insight to work on this. Finally, I say, Tvadiyam Vastu Govinda, Tubhyam Eva Samarpai. Dhanyavad.
Thank you, Dr. Shukuntala Gaudi, because your book was really a pleasure to read. I did manage to read most of it yesterday. I see this book as a really important innovation in the world of religious studies. For the longest time, religious studies scholars in the West, and especially in the States, haven't really had partners in India to work with, right? So this burgeoning field of interreligious studies, religious studies, the academic study of religion, is really exciting. And I see this as an entrance into that conversation. I really hope to work alongside scholars like Dr. Shukuntala in the future. For many, many generations, scholars in the West have relied on texts only in various languages, right? And we have, in the previous generation before mine, started working with practitioners of the religions as well, asking them what they think about their religious traditions, not just reading their texts. But what we've yet to do is work with scholars of these traditions who are looking at it from these various perspectives. I think that this is really exciting, and I hope to form a partnership with scholars like Dr. Gaudi in the future so we can look at all the angles possible on important texts like the Bhagavata Purana. I also see this book as a really important didactic tool, a teaching tool. I think you take a lot of the stories, the narratives, at face value. Someone who's never read the stories before, like an American student perhaps, might have a certain impression of these stories at face value. I myself, as a scholar of texts like this, don't see them in that way any longer. And I kind of forgot that this may be the way that students would take these narratives, right? And so this could be a great teaching tool for scholars like myself in the West, and then also here. I think that there are many people who hear these narratives, who hear these stories, and don't think about the deeper meanings or all the different perspectives. There's so much knowledge that can be gained from these stories, from these narratives, from the different commentaries. I think Dr. Gaudi is an excellent Sanskritist. He used a variety of sources. It was such a pleasure to read. It's very educational, and it will be very useful for my own research as well to see all of the different texts that you've pulled from in order to look at the various perspectives in your book. I don't think it's necessary always to pull from Western theories in order to understand Eastern religions. I think you've done an excellent job doing that. I think it's a really hard thing to do, and I don't think that it's always the right thing to do. I think that that's something that, unfortunately, Western scholars, generations before me, did too often, looking through a Western lens, looking through Western philosophy at Indian traditions. That's not always helpful. We've taken a step back from that, and we're trying to look through commentaries like Vullabhacharya's. But I think that in order to have a conversation across the seas, we need to look at all of the commentaries, all of the ways of looking at these kinds of texts. And I really hope to work with scholars like yourself in the future to do this very project. So I want to thank you for such a beautiful book. I really enjoyed reading it. I wish I could have had a little bit more time to enjoy it. I read it quite rapidly, but it was a pleasure. And this perspective of narratology that you bring, again, to these stories, I think is going to be a really helpful tool for students in the future. So thank you very much.
नरेटिव एनालिसिस ऑफ भागवत पुराण, ऐसा इस पुस्तक का शीर्षक है। इसकी प्रेरणा तो मुझे मिली है जब मैं अध्यापन कर रही थी भागवत पुराण के बारे में। तो भागवत पुराण का अगर हम अध्ययन करते हैं तो हमें दिखाई देता है कि कृष्ण चरित्र यही उसका मध्यवर्ती बिंदु है। कृष्ण चरित्र तो हम कई सालों से, कई पीढ़ियों से सुनते आए हैं। कृष्ण लीलाएं जो है वो हम सुनते हैं, किंतु केवल अद्भुत कथाएं या चमत्कृति इतना ही मान के हम छोड़ देते हैं, और फिर उस पर एक टीका भी होने लगती है, जैसे कि ये तो सिर्फ अद्भुत कथा ही है, इसमें से क्या लेना देना, क्या ये आधुनिक काल से सुसंगत है, क्या ये तर्कसंगत है। तो यह जो पुस्तक है वो वही प्रयास है कि भागवत पुराण में जो कृष्ण चरित्र है, कृष्ण लीलाएं है, उनका अर्थ क्या है। अभी ये अर्थ हमें अलग अलग स्तरों पर दिखाई देता है। सामाजिक अर्थ भी है, तत्वज्ञानिक अर्थ दिखाई देता है, मानसशास्त्रीय हम अर्थ देख सकते हैं। ऐसे विभिन्न अर्थ जो है वो इसकी कथनात्मक मीमांसा करके प्रस्तुत किए गए हैं। जैसे मैंने उदाहरण के तौर पर प्रस्तुत किया कि पूतना का जो वध हुआ है बालक कृष्ण के द्वारा, अभी ये जो पूरा प्रसंग है वो हम सुन के एक रोमांचक कथा ऐसे सुन के छोड़ देते हैं, अपितु ये पूतना कौन है, और भागवत जो कहता है कि पूतना को तो मोक्ष मिल गया, पूतना को सदगति मिल गई, फिर ऐसा क्यों है, क्या भागवत कहना चाहता है, फिर पूतना के मन में भी कोई परिवर्तन हुआ था क्या, भले ही वो आई थी कृष्ण का वध करने के लिए, का उसने उसे भेजा था, फिर बाद में क्या उसके मन में परिवर्तन हुआ, तो उसका मनोवैज्ञानिक विश्लेषण जो है वो ज़रूरी है। तो उस मनोवैज्ञानिक विश्लेषण में ये दिखाई देता है कि पूतना जब अपना स्तन्य कृष्ण को देती है उसके मन में परिवर्तन होता है, उसे लगता है यह अद्भुत बालक है, उसमें ममता जाग उठती है, और वह एक हम कह सकते हैं माता बन जाती है, और जो कृष्ण की माता है, जो कृष्ण के स्पर्श से पवित्र हुई है, तो उसको मोक्ष नहीं मिलेगा क्या। ये तो एक इंटरप्रिटेशन हो गया, एक अर्थनिश्चिति हो गई। दूसरी अर्थनिश्चिति मैंने ऐसी की है कि पूतना एक रोग का नाम है। सुश्रुत संहिता में इसका उल्लेख निर्देश दिखाई देता है। पूतना ये जो है वो स्तन्य से ही फैलने वाला एक रोग है, और पूतना का जो उल्लेख निर्देश है भागवत पुराण में वो भी बालक घातिनी, बालक ग्रही ऐसे किया गया है। तो दूसरा भी एक एंगल जिसे हम कह सकते हैं दृष्टिकोण, वो भी दिखाई देता है कि बालग्रही मीन्स देयर वॉज अ बिलीफ ऑन बालग्रहस, एक लोक कथाओं का जो एक लोक कथाएं या फिर बिलीफ सिस्टम जो होती है लोगों की, उसमें बाल ग्रहों पर बहुत श्रद्धा दिखाई देती है। इसलिए जब भी बालक का जन्म होता है पाँचवें दिन या छठे दिन हम कुछ ना कुछ रिचुअल्स जिसे करते, बहुत सारी विधियाँ करते हैं, क्योंकि इसी किसी की बुरी नज़र ना लगे या फिर दुष्ट शक्तियों का स्पर्श न हो। तो ऐसी भी कोई पूतना हो सकती है, इसका भी हमें एक निर्देश मिलता है। सो पूतना वध जो है वो पूतना मोक्ष ऐसे दिखाई देता है भागवत पुराण में। एंड देन आई हैव ट्राइड टू इंटरप्रेट पूतना एपिसोड फ्रॉम मल्टीफेरियस एंगल्स। सो लाइक दिस इन दिस बुक डिफरेंट एपिसोड्स आर एनालाइज्ड, लाइक बर्थ ऑफ चाइल्ड कृष्ण, कृष्ण जन्म जो है वो भी बहुत सारी चमत्कृतियों से भरा है। पूतना मोक्ष तो मैंने आपको बताया, फिर यमलार्जुन जो है उनको भी उखाड़ दिया था कृष्ण ने। एक छोटा बालक है वह जो है वो वृक्षों के बीच में से गुजरता है और वो बृहद जो वृक्ष है वो उनका उन्मूलन हो जाता है, तो उनका अर्थ क्या है। फिर बहुत सारे अलग अलग राक्षसों का वध किया, जैसे तृणावर्त है, वत्सासुर है, बकासुर है, अघासुर है, धेनुकासुर, तो उस कहानियों का मतलब क्या है। कालिया मर्दन तो हम जानते हैं, कालियाना, फिर उसका जो इंटरप्रिटेशन इस बुक में मैंने किया है वो सामाजिक दृष्टिकोण से किया है कि, और एक अलग भी दृष्टि दिखाई देती है, जैसे हम अभी एनवायरमेंटल एस्पेक्ट को बहुत महत्वपूर्ण मानते हैं, पर्यावरण दृष्टिकोण, क्योंकि कालिया ने पूरा जो एक वाटर रिजर्वायर था, एक जल स्रोत जो था वो पूरी तरह से बिगाड़ दिया था। सामान्य लोग जो है, जन सामान्य जो है वो उसका उपयोग नहीं कर पा रहे थे, वो कृष्ण ने उसे मुक्त कर दिया। सो ही कम्स एज अ फोक हीरो ऑल्सो, एक लोकनायक के मतलब लोकनायक के रूप में भी कृष्ण सामने आता है। उसमें स्पिरिचुअल मीनिंग तो है ही, आध्यात्मिक मीनिंग तो है ही, दिखाई देता है भागवत की हर एक कथा में आध्यात्मिक अर्थ है, उसके बावजूद कौन कौन से अर्थ है हम देख रहे हैं। फिर गोवर्धन पर्वत को उठाना, एक ही उंगली पे वो उठाते हैं, उसका क्या अर्थ हो सकता है, ये भी मैंने इस पुस्तक में बताया है। फिर गोपी चीरहरण और रास पंचाध्यायी, ये महत्वपूर्ण बहुत ही प्रसंग है, क्योंकि इसके ऊपर बहुत सारी टीकाएँ हमें उपलब्ध होती है, टिप्पणियाँ की जाती है कि अश्लील प्रसंग है, लेकिन फिर अगर हम भागवत पढ़ेंगे तो दिखाई देगा कि ये जो प्रसंग लिखे गए हैं या कहे गए हैं, कथन किए गए हैं, वो आध्यात्मिक दृष्टिकोण से ही कथन किए गए हैं। मतलब कथन शैली जो है वो ऐसी रखी गई है कि हमें उसका जो अंतर्निहित अर्थ है उसके प्रति जाना होगा। तो गोपी चीरहरणम और रास पंचाध्यायी, ये आध्यात्मिक अर्थ ही हमें लेने पड़ते हैं, व्यावहारिक उसका अर्थ नहीं हो सकता है। फिर भी रास क्रीड़ा की वजह से हम कृष्ण को हमेशा पहचानते हैं कि कृष्ण और रास क्रीड़ा एक अभिन्न संबंध है। तो क्या ये संबंध है एक्चुअली, दैट इज़ मधुरा भक्ति, क्योंकि गोपी जो है वो सामान्य स्त्रियाँ नहीं हैं, गोपियाँ जो है वो मुक्त जीव का एक प्रतीक है। अभी ये मुक्ति की संकल्पना ही अलग है, मुक्ति यानी क्या, मतलब ये जीवन से मुक्त हो जाना, उतना ही मुक्ति का या मोक्ष का अर्थ है क्या, नहीं। भागवत के अनुसार मोक्ष यानी उस भगवान के साथ रममाण होना, उसके साथ कुछ संबंध प्रस्थापित करना। तो भागवत के अनुसार यशोदा, नंद, सारी गोपियाँ, ये सारे मुक्त जीव है और मुक्ति का आनंद ले रहे हैं। मुक्ति यानी आनंद, इट इज़ अ टोटल ब्लिस। व्यावहारिक जीवन में हम सुख दुख सभी का अनुभव करते हैं, आनंद नहीं अनुभव कर सकते, प्योर ब्लिस इज़ नॉट अवेलेबल टू अस, लेकिन मुक्ति यानी सिर्फ आनंद। और ये जो एपिसोड्स है, गोपी चीरहरणम, रास पंचाध्यायी, दे टॉक अबाउट दैट रिलेशन, दैट स्पेशल रिलेशन ऑफ मधुरा भक्ति, वेयर यू सी गॉड एज योर लवर, आप भगवान को आपके पति के रूप में देखते हैं, क्योंकि पति पत्नी का जो संबंध होता है वो एक अलग स्तर पे होता है, तन्मयता का होता है। ऐसा संबंध हमें प्रस्थापित करना चाहिए भगवान के साथ, यह संदेश ये दो जो प्रसंग है वो देते हैं। फिर कुब्जा का प्रसंग भी यहाँ पे बताया है, रुक्मिणी स्वयंवर एक प्रसंग जो है उसका मैंने एकनाथ का जो एकनाथ जी जो है जिस जिनका महाराष्ट्र के वारकरी संप्रदाय में बहुत महत्वपूर्ण स्थान है, तो एकनाथ जी का रुक्मिणी स्वयंवर नाम का ग्रंथ है, तो भागवत के से प्रेरित होकर एकनाथ जी रुक्मिणी स्वयंवर लिखते हैं, तो कैसे वेरिएशंस आए हैं, कैसे उसमें अलग अलग भिन्न प्रवाह आए हैं एकनाथ जी का, और तत्वज्ञान हमें क्या दिखाई देता है वो भी इसमें स्पष्ट किया गया है। फिर स्यमंतक मणि का एक प्रसंग आता है कि कृष्ण पर चोरी का आरोप लगता है, तो फिर ये क्यों लगा? अगर कृष्ण को भगवान मानते हैं, भागवत पुराण में अगर कृष्ण को स्वयं ब्रह्म ही माना गया है, तो ऐसा प्रसंग क्यों आ गया, इसकी भी मीमांसा की गई है। क्योंकि फिर हरिवंश, जैसे कि ये किताब जो है इसमें हरिवंश, विष्णु पुराण, भागवत पुराण, ब्रह्म वैवर्त पुराण, और उसके बाद भी जैसे मैंने अभी वारकरी संप्रदाय के बारे में बताया, उसमें जो एक विभिन्नता आई है कथानकों के बारे में, कथानकों के विषयों में, उसकी मीमांसा भी की गई है। फिर एक श्रीदामन प्रसंग जो है, जिसे हम सुदामा के नाम से जानते हैं, कि सुदामा जो है वो कृष्ण के पास जाते हैं कुछ मांगने के लिए, लेकिन कुछ मांग नहीं पाते, और लौट के आते हैं तो उनको दिखता है सब ऐश्वर्य मिल चुका है, तो ये भी एक चमत्कृति पूर्ण प्रसंग है। तो ये क्या है चमत्कृति? तो इसका एक तर्कशुद्ध विवेचन जो है वो किया गया है, संशोधनात्मक विवेचन जो किया गया है, और इसके लिए जो एक मेथडोलॉजी उपयुक्त की गई है वो है नरेटिव एनालिसिस, यानी कथन शास्त्रीय विश्लेषण। तो भारतीय कथन शास्त्रीय सिद्धांत, उसका उपयोजन किया गया है, उसके ही साथ साथ पाश्चात्य समीक्षक जो है, जैसे जेनेट रोला बार्थ, उनके जो सिद्धांत है उनका भी उपयोजन यहाँ पे किया गया है। तो इस कुछ नरेटिव्स के माध्यम से, कुछ प्रसंग भागवत के कुछ प्रसंगों के माध्यम से ऐसा एक प्रस्थापित करने की कोशिश की है कि पुराण यानी केवल चमत्कृति पूर्ण कथाएं ऐसा नहीं है, उनमें कुछ अर्थ है। तो कभी तत्वज्ञानात्मक अर्थ है, कभी सामाजिक कुछ तत्व उसमें छुपे हैं, कभी कुछ मॉरल टीचिंग जिसे हम कहते हैं नैतिकता जो है वो भी वो सिखाते हैं, या कभी कोई हिस्टोरिकल प्रिंसिपल हम जिसे कहते हैं, कोई ऐतिहासिक संदर्भ, एक घटना घट गई थी लेकिन उसे कहने का जो एक कहने की जो पद्धति थी पुराणों की वो अलग थी। अब हमें इतिहास जो अभी हमें पढ़ाते हैं वो एक अलग दृष्टिकोण से पढ़ाते हैं, जैसे कि क्रोनोलॉजिकल हिस्ट्री हम पढ़ाते हैं, वी हैव क्रोनोलॉजीज विच हैपेंड इन दिस ईयर दैट ईयर एक्सेट्रा, बट तभी जो शैली थी हमारे प्राचीन इतिहासकारों की जो शैली थी, जिन्होंने रामायण महाभारत लिखी या फिर पुराण व्यास जी ने ही लिखी ऐसे कहा जाता है, तो ये शैली जो थी वो कथनात्मक शैली थी। जो एक तत्व बताना है इतिहास में घटा हुआ, तो वो कैसे बताना है? कथाओं के माध्यम से बताना है। तो कथाओं को सिर्फ हम मनोरंजन का साधन नहीं कह सकते हैं, उसमें कुछ बहुत सारे गहन तत्व छुपे हुए हैं, वो हमें जानना चाहिए। इसका प्रबोधन ज़रूर ये पुस्तक कर पाएगा, ऐसी मेरी मनीषा है।
इस किताब को लिखने के दौरान उसके स्रोत क्या रहे हैं, कहाँ से आपको ये सब थॉट्स वगैरह मिले?
मेन सोर्स तो था भागवत पुराण, फिर उसके ऊपर बहुत सारे व्याख्याएं लिखी गई है, जैसे कि अद्वैत, द्वैत, विशिष्टाद्वैत, शुद्धाद्वैत, अचिंत्य भेदा भेद, इन सभी संप्रदायों के आचार्यों ने इस पे व्याख्याएं लिखी गई है, तो इन व्याख्यानों का तो मैंने आधार लिया ही है। फिर हरिवंश, विष्णु पुराण, ब्रह्म वैवर्त पुराण और कुछ अलग अलग जो ग्रंथ है उसका भी एक स्रोत आधार उपयुक्त किया गया है। फिर बहुत सारे सेकेंडरी सोर्सेस, जिन्होंने भागवत पर पहले रिसर्च किया है, पहले संशोधन किया है, वो तो देखना ज़रूरी है, क्योंकि वो भागवत के बारे में क्या कहना चाहते हैं, वो इन कथाओं के बारे में क्या कहना चाहते हैं, उन्होंने इनका अर्थ क्या जाना है, और मैं क्या इसके बारे में बोल सकती हूँ। तो इसके लिए बहुत सारे दुय्यम जो स्रोत है, यानी पाश्चात्य संशोधक और उसके ही साथ साथ भारतीय संशोधक का भी बहुत सारा मार्गदर्शन इस बारे में उपलब्ध हुआ है।
लोगों तक कैसे पहुंचेगी, क्या ऑनलाइन भी?
यस,
लैंग्वेजेज में आएगी?
अभी तो सिर्फ अंग्रेज़ी में है, और इट इज़ अवेलेबल ऑन अमेजॉन, एग्जॉटिक इंडिया आर्ट, फिर देव पब्लिशर की वेबसाइट पे भी उपलब्ध है, तो इन सभी से पुस्तक ऑर्डर की जा सकती है। मे बी इन फ्यूचर, भविष्य में शायद इसका प्रयास कर सकती हूँ, क्योंकि एक मुझे इसमें दिखाई दिया, ये बुक तो संशोधन ऊपर, मतलब संशोधन पर बुक पुस्तक है, फिर भी सामान्य जो एक वाचक वर्ग है उसे भी बहुत सारी जानने की जिज्ञासा है कृष्ण चरित्र के बारे में, कृष्ण लीला के बारे में, क्योंकि वो हमारे क्या कह सकते हैं, हमारे रग रग में अनुस्यूत है कृष्ण चरित्र, हम जानते ही है बचपन से, सुनते आए हैं उसमें, तो उसका अर्थ क्या हो सकता है, सामान्य वाचकों की भी जिज्ञासा है। तो डेफिनेटली इन फ्यूचर आई विल डेफिनेटली प्लान टू ट्रांसलेट इट और राइट यूजर फ्रेंडली बुक विच विल बी टेकन। हाँ, क्योंकि इसमें अभी मैंने प्रसंग बताए वो सिलेक्टेड ही थे, क्योंकि उसमें बहुत सारी मीमांसा करनी थी, तो अभी तो मैं ऐसे एक सोच रही हूँ, लेकिन बाय कृष्णज, लॉर्ड कृष्णज ग्रेस इफ पॉसिबल, मैं चाहूँगी कि और, क्योंकि भागवत तो एक अथांग समुद्र की तरह है, तो उसमें से और भी मैं कुछ प्रसंग लूँ, और तो देखेंगे 2 volumes या 3 volumes में भी शायद ये प्रकाशित हो सकती है।
थैंक यू
थैंक यू थैंक यू